The reason my favorite symbol is a sword is because I'm a warfighter from the head, from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. And I demand that every soldier in my corps be a warfighter. If you're a technician, then you ought to get out and go to work for Mr. Goodrich or Kroger's, not be in the United States Army. You see, there's a whole line of your peers out there of the combat arms, no offense, sir, who would like you to feel like you're less important than they are. So they put you down and they use terms like loggy, log toad, techie. We do not accept that in the Quartermaster Corps, and we stand toe-to-toe with them and look them dead in the eye and let them know that combat service support is the sinews of war. And so when the balloon goes up and when times are really hard and when results count because our national prestige is riding on the outcome of a hard task, these warfighters will call on you because they know you can do the job. And you'll be there with them when it ends and not crater, okay? Warfighters, all of you.
A great adventure, a great ride. Dusty, muddy boots, you name it. From Washington, D.C., to here in Germany, to Bosnia, Fort Bragg, and places unknown and in between. One great American. What do I remember most about him? Number one, his saying that he took from General Creighton Abrams. What this country needs, it cannot buy. It needs dedicated soldiers for whom service to their country is an affair of the heart, and certainly it was an affair of Jimmy's heart. Second of all, he always told us, the lead dog has the best view. Second best view is wingman right and left, and I was glad to do that. And would do it again in a heartbeat. And the last thing Jimmy did that I've never seen before, but it showed you where he came from and what he believed in was the best thing in our Army with non-commissioned officers. Jimmy Wright is the only general officer in the history of this G4 or any other place who had a Sergeant First Class for his XO.
Chicken Man, as we affectionately knew him, was probably the epitome of the multifunctional logistician. He was also one of the smartest, forward-thinking logisticians of our time. He was a leader, certainly an all-inclusive leader, and a team builder. Everyone wanted to be part of his team, and he just about invited anyone who wanted to be part of the team to join him in his successes. It was an honor for him to come along and punch you really hard in the shoulder and call you Bud, a Budette. If that happened, you knew that you were part of his team.
In 1996, as a mobilized reservist, I was excited for the opportunity to work for General Wright because I knew of his reputation as a talented logistician and someone who understood reservist civilian skills. And I will say that he unabashedly used their skills to his operational advantage. He set high standards, and because of his exuberant style of leadership, everyone was willing to give their best. General Wright was a good friend, a strong supporter of the reserve components, and a consummate logistician who made serving as a soldier meaningful and fun.
General Wright truly believed in the non-commissioned officer, and he proved this every day. He showed his trust in us by empowering us to do what we had to do to accomplish the mission. General Wright had a special gift by making everyone feel important. After you had talked to General Wright about almost anything, you knew he valued you as part of the team. Good communicators are also good storytellers. General Wright was one of the best. He could tell you the story about Specialist Mulholland, who was a heavy soldier. But as he told the story, Mulholland was heavy because when PT was being conducted, Mulholland was in the motor pool fixing vehicles because, you see, he was the best mechanic in the company. And then after they realized that, General Wright got Mulholland and his supervisor together. Mulholland started to come to PT, lost the weight, got promoted. Again, it's just a great story with a great message. Hardly a day goes by that I don't think of General Wright. Some of the things he says, I still have a lot of his sayings posted on my wall and share them with people today as the situation rises.
Probably the most important thing I remember about General Wright is that he never, ever forgot to say thank you. Whether you were a brigade commander or the custodian of Mifflin Hall, or you were the guy out there on Say Field that ran the sound system, he appreciated what you did. It didn't usually come in the form of a medal or a certificate, but just a pat on the back and a sincere, "You done good, bud," or "budette." And if you were fortunate enough to receive one of the Chicken Man's trademark fist bumps to the chest, well, you wore that as a badge of honor.
When Jim and I started our careers, our commanders were not well known for having a great sense for the pulse of the men and women in their formations. The great ones have always emerged with every generation because they knew their soldiers and they knew the soldiers' families. His legacy continues even today with the young officers, warrant officers, non-commissioned officers, and enlisted soldiers he touched in his life of leading and caring for soldiers and their families. I remember early on when I arrived to the Army's training command and visited Jim and Carol. The focus and priority for preparing soldiers for their role in the Army logistics formations was everywhere at Fort Lee. In short order, the field commanders knew if they got a soldier from Fort Lee, that soldier was ready to join the team and make a contribution from day one. What Jim could do was translate the Army standards for professionalism with universal application to logistics soldiers for every type of unit and formation for the Army.
That I will well and faithfully.
And that I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duty.
Discharge the duty.
Of the office.
Of the office.
Upon which.
Upon which.
I'm about to enter.
I'm about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Hey, congratulations.
There's nothing better than being part of a huge Army family that I've come to love so much. Leaders like Carl Freeman, Zanie Smith, General Dan McNeil, Stan McChrystal, Dave Petraeus, General Hugh Shelton, and who could forget Chicken Man Wright?
Now, on the day I was born, the nurses all gathered round. They gazed in wide wonder at the joy they had found. The head nurse spoke up, said, "Leave this one alone." She could tell right away that I was bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad. 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 Bad to the bone. Hearts before I met you. I'll break 1,000 more, baby, before I am through. I wanna be yours, pretty baby, yours and yours alone. I'm here to tell you, honey, that I'm bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Woman beg, and I make a good woman steal. I make an old woman blush, and I make a young girl squeal. Wanna be yours, pretty baby, yours and yours.
I am proud to be quartermaster, and I am proud to represent the thousands of quartermaster soldiers throughout our Army, and the tens of thousands of quartermaster soldiers and civilians who have gone before. In the words of Creighton Abrams, they were people
of great honor who saw service to their country as an affair of the heart. And thanks to all of you for being a part of this great Corps and this great ceremony. God bless you for what you do for your country.
Bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad. Bad to the bone.